I'm going to talk about public health and public mental health, which increasingly in the world of psychology, social science, is the paradigm. ISTSS theme this year is all about public health and public mental health. And my talk is mostly about the practice of doing the job on the ground. I'm not going to talk so much about research. I'm going to take you in an imaginary situation where in your own country, when there's a disaster or there's political violence, what you will do to set up a public health program. These are the countries where I've worked in the course of my life. In a number of these countries, we have set up NGOs, like we have somebody from Cambodia here, from Nepal. Cambodia has 300-400 collaborators, Nepal as well. They do everything on their own, all their management, all their fundraising, all their programs, etc. So that's the background, and I will talk from a science point of view, but I'm not going to present data, although all our work is thoroughly interdisciplinary. If you want to do this kind of work, I always say in ranking order, you need to be an anthropologist, you need to be a sociologist, you need to be a psychologist, you need to be a psychotherapist. And the qualitative science comes for the quantitative science. So we spend 70% of our time setting up interventions in these countries and 30% of our time we did research. All kinds of research, randomized controlled trials, cost-effectiveness research, etc. So first I'm going to tell you a bit about why do we embrace this paradigm of public health and public mental health, then the exercise comes, and then I'm going to talk about a few challenges in psychology, whether it's clinical, social, or community psychology. Now, most of our colleagues work from a social ecological paradigm. You probably know the name of Bronfenbrenner, or we use it as a social ecological multi-system level paradigm, going from the individual to the family to the mesostructure and the macrostructure of society. And on all these levels, I'm going to mention a few arguments why we like this public health paradigm. Now, if you look at the effect of psychotherapy, you see that at the meta-analytic level, that universal therapist variables, they explain about 30% of the effect. Universal variables like empathy and trust that we have in common with priests and healers. Contextual variables, they account for 40% of the effect. Employment, family relations, intimate relations. Technique of psychotherapy explains only 15% of the effect. Now that's quite scary, isn't it? Because many of us, we've spent many, many years in being trained in psychotherapy, and it only explains a limited amount of the effect. By the way, you don't need to take notes, because everybody will get these notes by tonight, these slides. Maybe it's useful if you have a question later to write that down, but don't feel like you have to keep it, because sometimes I go very quick, and you may later feel like I'll read it over when you get the slides. So technique, only 15%. So here, on the level of contextual variables when you talk about psychotherapy, that's an important element. Now if we go to another level, another system level, and we talk about the availability of professionals, mental health, social science, whatever professionals in the world, this is a map of WHO. And here you see the area of the world, this broad range here, where the majority of disasters, indicated with a D, or political violence takes place. And this light green area around the world are the places where you will hardly find any psychologists, and when you find a psychologist, it's often an industrial psychologist testing people for commercial jobs. You don't hardly find psychiatric nurses, you hardly find social sciences people, social workers, or psychiatrists. Or there are some, like Sri Lanka has about 34 psychiatrists, but there are about 750 psychiatrists from Sri Lanka in the UK and the USA. So There's a whole range of countries in this part of Africa where there is one psychologist, one clinical psychologist, and one psychiatrist per country. Whereas there's an enormous concentration of problems in those countries. Then if you compare high-income countries to low-income countries, the involvement in political violence is about 1 to 10. So low-income countries have much more political violence and war. And when it comes to the disasters, high-income countries have 3 times more disasters and cyclones, etc. But the casualties, again, are 10 to 8, much more elevated in low-income countries than in high-income countries. And if you look at the next slide, here you see that in this year, we'll have 65 displaced people in the world, 2.5 million of them in Turkey, 1.5 million in Pakistan, 1 million in Lebanon. The main producers are Afghanistan and Syria. And then you see that the Pacific region takes 14% of these refugees around the world. The Middle East, almost 40%. And Europe and the US, where we make a lot of fuss, Europe only takes 6% of those refugees, and the Americas only 12%. So there is a very unequal burden in terms of the problems that people confront after disasters and the professionals that are there to help them. Now, if you look at other factors, you see that there is a huge treatment gap, even in times of peace, and that treatment gap increases after disasters or war. The burden of mental disease, 11%, is huge. 24% of cases in developed countries and 6% in low and middle income countries do receive treatment. We'll get back to that. That it applies both to children and to adults. I put this slide of September 11 here to show you that a sole clinical focus is never going to solve the problem. September 11 was a very tiny disaster, 3,000 dead people. You compare it to any disaster in your own countries. New York has the highest density of psychologists and psychotherapists in the world, but they couldn't handle the people that needed treatment. Now, what do we do in the areas where we work, where there are almost no professionals, and where the disasters make many more casualties? Now, when there is disaster, the treatment gets larger due to a number of factors that has to do with the clients or the beneficiaries. They may express the psychopathology in other ways. We get back to that. They may handle different explanatory models. They may exhibit different illness behavior. They may express their suffering in spiritual, religious, family, or community terms. The people who get treatment, they often belong to a different ethnic group than the providers, to a different ethnic group, to also to a different socioeconomic. They may speak another language. Then there is a whole range of factors that increase the treatment gap in times of disasters because of the services we deliver. We have often very few resources in terms of infrastructure, human resources, policies. We have often very few professionals, and the professionals, they may either go away or they may be somewhere else. Like when I went to Hainan, here in the Philippines, I went to the Hainan area after Hainan's typhoon. I think there were 3 psychologists in the area, there were 3 psychiatrists. Yeah? And in countries like Afghanistan or Rwanda or Burundi, the professionals, they've escaped the country. Our delivery models are often not prepared to massive stress due to social or colonial history. So we often have mental health models that date back to the English or French or whatever colonial time. Our professionals have often very limited training in trauma therapy. The survivors of the disaster, they may live in the rural areas, but intellectuals and professionals often remain in the cities. And the state sector is weak. And because the state sector is weak, and because there's no public health structure, and because in the public health structure there are no mental health professionals, many people have to survive by having a private practice. And when you're running your private practice to survive in the capital, you can't go out there to one of the islands when there is a a typhoon or a cyclone. So these are some of these factors. Now let me get to public mental health. I'm going to present you a model that accommodates different age groups. It's resilience, ecology, family-oriented. It uses a spectrum approach towards what we commonly now denominate as mental health and psychosocial services. It describes universal steps used in an eclectic, integrative way, going from a few interventions to many, or many for few. What I mean to say there is this. If you set up something in your country, or in a neighboring country, you can take a large catchment area and set up some basic essential services post-disaster. In that large area, you may say, I'm just going to train the primary care physicians and nurses in essential psychological techniques or psychological first aid. Then in that big area, you may, over the years, gradually add interventions on children, whatever. Or you may say, the other way around, I take a small catchment area of 10 or 20 or 40,000 people and I set up a very comprehensive program with very different psychological interventions in conjunction with the educational sector, in conjunction with the social sector, in conjunction with rural development sector. And then, after you've piloted that, expand that to a larger area in your country. These are two different approaches. Another thing is, you may start at a community level, which in general we like, and gradually build up towards the provinces or academia, but you may also start in academia and descend into the communities. It's also important that when we talk about disaster public mental health, it's not totally different from what we do every day. It's not like when you work in disasters or in political violence situation that you have a totally different. No, it's again in a continuum what you do every day, and you then often have to scale up. We know that. The model I'm going to talk about fits both peace, disaster, and conflict, and it's compatible with other models, the protective or child right approach, the UNICEF lights, the community-based rehabilitation model that the WHO lights, the torture center model, or the interagency standing committee, or the sphere guidelines. Okay, now let's get to the model, but I want to talk a bit about primary prevention. Now when you look at disaster on a global and a global scale, it's more important whether the disaster takes place in a low-income country or a high-income country. That's the most important predictor in low-income countries in terms of casualties, distress, and the burden of refugees. Meaning that we are living in an increasingly unequal world, and addressing those social inequalities is the best prevention intervention anywhere in the world, whether it comes to health and disease, or whether it comes to political violence, or whatever. And here you see that in this slide, and I would like you to ask to look only at this, these factors here. These are the most important predictors of political violence, and also very often the most important predictors for ill health, and the most important predictors for the consequences of disasters. It's a lack of democracy, it's socio-economic inequity, which is increasing almost everywhere in the world, socio-economic inequity. It's the marginalization of groups along ethnic or religious lines. It's a lack of intersectional collaboration within the government structure between education, health, social work, etc. And health and nutritional indicators are not only a consequence of disasters and political violence, but they are also predictor in itself, which is interesting. So you often see that the health system goes down, the health indicators go down, and they add fuel to the development of political conflicts. Now, The most important paper in the world on prevention is an old paper by Rose, who did research on hypertension. And that's why all our hypertension prevention in all our countries where we live has to do with reducing the amount of salt in our work. Now, if you use Rose's model in mental health, you see here, you see a normal distribution. And you see here, you see percentage of the population that has a mental disorder versus the percentage of the population that's flourishing and everything in between. And you see that if you are able, for whatever reason, to change the determinants of ill mental health, the determinants of ill health in general, if you are able to shift those predictors and those variables, those determinants, a little bit, you see that the prevalence and the incidence of psychological problems very quickly decreases. So, if you look at this part here, of this dotted line, then you see that as soon as the determinants change to the right, that here, the amount of people with a mental disorder decreases very quick. So that's an important issue, that when we are able to decrease the importance of those determinants, that it has a large impact in terms of mental well-being or mental disease. Okay, so now we get to the situation where you go to a certain area in the world and you want to set up a program. You first start with an assessment. And what do you assess? It has been extensively described in these interagency standing committee guidelines. You assess on many, many levels what is taking place. So you want to know what are the core characteristics of the emergency. What do the policy makers, the politicians, what do the UN agencies think? What reports do they have? What are the people's experiences, responses, and the threats? Then you want to map the resources and the needs, both in terms of human resources, training resources. You want to know about support mechanisms, coping skills, about stigmas, about taboos and shame, when, for example, the gender-based violence. You want to involve the community, you want to involve the healers, you want to create local ownership, which is extremely important if you want to set up a sustainable program. You want to know about all kinds of rituals, mourning rituals, reconciliation, cleansing rituals. And you want to know what is happening in the communities. You want to map the resources, you want risk analysis, community response plans, early warning systems, etc. We'll get back to that later in one of the exercises that we're going to do. So you collect a lot of data. You can do this, let's say, in 2, 3, 4 weeks with a small team. You can use rapid appraisal techniques, rapid anthropological techniques, etc., etc. And then you have a massive amount of data after 3, 4 weeks. You have like 100 to 120 pages of data. And then you have to set up a program, isn't it? You always have lack of resources and a lack of money. So then the question is, if you have all these things, how do you define what you're going to do? What are your criteria? How do you define priorities? Because it's very hard. You can't say, I have $50 million, I'm going to Tacloban, I'm going to set up a program. No, that's not how it works. Okay, the two most important criteria are community concern and epidemiology. Now, we love the epidemiology, the prevalence and the incidence, but the community concern is often much more important. It's what the local people want, it's what their problems are. And they are really different types of sports. The community concerns and the community needs is something you find out with social science. You look at perceived needs and concerns of the people, you look at the idioms of distress, the cultural concepts of distress, as it's called in DSM-5, idioms of distress, the cultural syndromes, local ways of expressing problems, not in terms of DSM or ICD, but in local terms, EMIC terms. Concern addresses suffering and psychological pain. You may repeat that every 1 to 2 years, and it takes only 2 to 8 weeks to do this, and you use EMIC techniques, anthropological, qualitative techniques. When you talk about prevalence and incidence in epidemiology, you do quantitative research, preferably culturally informed epidemiology. You look at disorders and their distribution, depression, alcohol, PTSD. You assess morbidity, mortality, disability, quality of life. You would like to do longitudinal studies, but that seldomly happens. Mostly we do call it cross-sectional studies. And if you do a good epidemiological study, that takes you 1 to 3 years. So you are stuck with the problem. Either you take the epidemiological figures from elsewhere in the world, or you go with your community concern that you can kind of assess quite quickly. And here, of course, you use mixed methods. If you do good epidemiological research these days, you combine qualitative methods with quantitative methods, and we'll get back to that again later. Okay, then other criteria. These were the most important. Severity in terms of daily disability adjusted life years, in terms of PAR, proportional tributal risk proportions, population tributal risk proportions, quality of life stigma is important. Then fourth criterion is, can I treat it? Do I have people who are able to treat it? When I distill a priority, can I train my local workers, my social workers, my nurses, my doctors? Can they treat it? Is what I'm going to do, is it sustainable? Sustainability being a dimension of quality, volume, and time in terms of volume, you have to train many people. You have to continue training to make sure that when people leave to other jobs that you still have enough people in the area. So you want enough volume of people you train. But you also want that these people have quality, so you have to give a refresher training. And you want to maintain that quality over time. These are the three most important aspects of sustainability. You also want to know what are the skills of the existing mental health professionals in the area or the other healthcare professionals, and what do they do? Is there competition? What we often do is we say, okay, we take primary care workers, nurses and doctors, but they're already overburdened. So that's one of the things. Is what you do is politically acceptable? You may want to do epidemiological research, you think, okay, I have to look at an exposure to trauma, I have to look at the burden that people went through. You have your list with all the trauma inventories, etc., etc., etc. But then the local politicians may think you are related to Amnesty International and you want to collect data on human rights violations. So what you have to be very much aware of what you do, whether it's political acceptable. Is it ethical acceptable? If you do research, do you also try to translate that research into interventions? Is it culture sensitive? We'll get back to that. And is it cost effective? Because the funders, like the World Bank and other funders, they say, well, these psychologists, they want to do interventions, you know, but I can also do a treatment for night blindness with vitamin A, whatever vitamin, that's much cheaper. So that's how they reason, the economists at the World Bank. They say it's cost effective. If you say I want to do an intervention, and my cyclone era, it's only $20 per person. Then the World Bank says, but you know, these nutritional people, they only need $3 per person. So you need cost-effectiveness data. It's a very competitive world in that sense. Okay, now you've done two things. So you did your assessment, you got your data, and you had your priorities. You make kind of a table. You think these selection criteria are more important, you have an idea or what you want to do. Then you want some kind of a model to understand what you're going to do. And this, of course, is the famous public health pyramid. There you see the agency standing committee guidelines. That's this interagency of all UN agencies together in New York. They have set up these guidelines. And like always in public health, you have basic services and security. Then you have community family support in our field. Focus non-specialized services that you can train to local paraprofessionals or lay people. And then you have the specialized services, which is often people like you, the psychologists, the psychiatrists, the doctors, who can provide, who can treat PTSD or depression, etc. Now this is a very simple model, but what I'll show you is a kind of a mansion, a house, showing, this is the house with the roof, kind of the type of interventions that you can do at the macro level of society, at the community level, at the family level, and talking here about universal, selective, and indicated interventions. Does everybody know what it is, universal, selective, indicated interventions? Or are you trained with primary, secondary, tertiary prevention? Well, this is kind of the new lingo of primary, secondary, tertiary prevention, you might say. So universal prevention, preventative interventions are targeted at the general public or a whole population group that has not been identified on the basis of individual risk. So if you do psychoeducation after a cyclone and you explain to people what the effect is of PTSD, that's a universal intervention. Vaccination programs are universal interventions. Selective preventive are targeted at subgroups of individuals whose risk of developing a problem is significantly higher than average. The risk may be imminent or lifetime. Think of accumulation risk factors during emergencies. So you may say, well, there is a whole range of children in my area who lost a parent, who are dislocated, and they are in orphanages or they're in shelters. So that's a selective intervention if you work for that group. Indicated are targeted high-risk individuals who are adventurous, have minimal but detectable signs of symptoms, foreshadowing a problem of disorder. So these may be people who have distress, who have symptoms of acute stress disorder, they have symptoms of minor depression, and you think if I don't do anything for them, they may get a very serious depression, or their acute stress symptoms may develop into PTSD. So that's how we reason. Now one of the things in our field is that when you go out there in the field, you know there's always a lot of competition. I don't know whether you notice that. There's competition between government and NGOs, there's competition between NGOs and other NGOs, and there's also competition between all the UN agencies. They are as childish as the NGOs. You think they're out there in the big world, they're important, they come from New York and Geneva, but they're as childish as every other human being. So this slide, I made this slide to kind of prevent this kind of competition and professional envy that's often going on. Because in my view, when it comes to the macro level, the international level, that's where the UN should mainly be active. I think the government should be more active at the level of the provinces or the districts or the communities. And the NGOs and the community-based organizations, they should be more active in the communities, the families, and individual cases. So that is at least a kind of a tendency to collaborate instead of to compete. And you'll see that when you get the slides tonight, here is a whole range of interventions that are preventative. Open economy, democracy, free media and press, respect for human rights, setting standards for intervention and training, research, they are all important preventative intervention. Now if you look at this model, then only here, the level of selective interventions, here is where you find the public health and disease control, the care for AIDS, tuberculosis, etc. And this is also where comes the mental health and psychosocial support. So we are only part of a much bigger agenda, a much bigger framework. Now, when we do this work over the last years, you know, there have always been guidelines, there have been training guidelines, and the WHO has now developed this MAH gap intervention guide, which, you know, all of you know the MAH gap? Who knows it? Or, yeah, I see some heads setting up. This is a booklet with decision rules, with flow charts, which you as mental health professionals can use to train other people, to train primary care doctors, to train primary care nurses, to train local social workers, to train community people in recognizing a number of psychological problems. And it tells you also what to do. And they're evidence-based. And they're being tested in a number of countries. So this is a very useful guide, and it exists in many, many, many languages. But we have to realize that that intervention guide is kind of written as a universal prescriptive thing, and it needs local cultural adaptation. And it needs long-term implementation, meaning you have to train and train and train to really keep people going on. And you know that when you train people wherever you are in the world and you don't supervise, training makes no sense. It has no use. If you don't supervise very intensively, you get repeatedly to the field, it won't work. And then, this focuses very much on kind of diseases, disorders. It's a kind of medical model. And the reason the WHO has chosen for that medical model is because the mental health division in Geneva has to compete with other medical sectors. And they think that if we talk about depression and anxiety and PTSD, it makes us more acceptable. So it gives us more status within that UN agency that's determined by doctors. So you have to, we have to realize that there are many other resources, religious resources, community resources, healing resources. Okay, so when it comes to treatment, we tend and we want to treat people with medium high levels of distress, and we want to use evidence-based treatments, isn't it? Now, this slide condensates the largest meta-analysis that has been done so far on the treatment of PTSD, acute stress disorder, and grief. This was an exercise by WHO. This is a paper in PLOS, this is another paper in the JAMA. We looked at all the literature of the world, also all the Asian literature, in Chinese, in Japanese, etc. So this is the most extensive study. Now look, this was a huge, huge, huge thing. I chaired that group. And this is the result, which is horrible. What we know about what we should do. Let me go very quick through it. Acute traumatic stress. What is recommended? Strong recommendation. Cognitive behavioral therapy with a trauma focus. No benzodiazepines or antidepressants to adults and children. Now please remember that. No benzodiazepines when there is acute disaster. Let people pray. Let them meditate. Let them do this and that. But don't prescribe benzodiazepines even if there's pressure. And if you do it not more than 2 or 3 days, and then again 2 days in the next week. But it's no evidence. And everybody does it. Insomnia, relaxation techniques, again, no benzodiazepines. Secondary bedwetting, no punitive response, simple behavioral interventions. We don't have good evidence for treatment of illnesses for bedwetting of children. We have an alarm clock, but in many disaster areas you don't have electricity, you can't use that alarm clock
for children. Hyperventilation, we don't know what to do about it, but we know that you shouldn't use a paper bag, as many of us tended to do. PTSD, trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy, EMDR, stress management for adults and youth. That's the evidence we have. Again, no SSRIs, no tricyclics as first-line treatment for adults and youth. So don't start just with antidepressants, but use psychological interventions on this PTSD. Bereavement without a mental disorder, we don't have structured psychological interventions, but we know don't use benzodiazepines. So here you may use religious rituals for people who either do how they will go to church, whatever, when there's bereavement and grief, isn't it? So this is very disappointing. Realize how little we know, how little evidence we have, for example, on children and adolescents in the world. So if you talk about research, you take this paper and PLOS, and you look at all the empty holes, and you say, why should we develop research over the next years to deal with trauma? Yeah? Okay. What are some of the barriers to uptake of mental health interventions? Well, one of the barriers is that most of the research exists for PTSD by specialized professionals. And we just realized that there are very few professionals in these areas, isn't it? But most people have common mental disorder, anxiety, depression. They have problems with daily tasks for survival and recovery. If you want to scale up to reach larger populations, the intervention should be short duration, they should be simple, they should be carried out by primary care people or in the community. Brief interventions may prevent more serious disorders. That's an assumption. But that's what we think, what we believe. CBT, narrative exposure therapy, EMDR are good candidates, but they need cultural adaptation, cultural competence. We have very few, we have in fact no evidence, no good evidence on family interventions. That's very serious. We talk about collectivistic, social-centric, interdependent cultures in Asia and Africa, but we have no good evidence for family-based interventions. Again, there's a huge research gap. There's very good interventions, you know, PPP developed in Australia, etc., etc., but we haven't applied it in our field. Interventions should address a range of outcomes, including functioning, and not just depression and PTSD where we do research. There is a good candidate, that's PIAD plus problem management, plus 5 sessions that reduce symptoms of depression, anxiety, PTSD. It can be used by non-specialized workers or lay people. It can be used in individuals and groups. And there is evidence. So PIAD plus, if you're in this field, this is a very, very good intervention. Don't use psychological first aid, in my view. In most countries where I work, psychological first aid is too simple. It's what people have been doing. When after Heimel, people have been doing all the things that are psychological first aid, and then NGOs came in and they told the Filipino local people, well, you have to do psychological first aid. So the local Filipino people, they looked and they said, well, we've been doing this all the way through. That's what in most cultures happens. So psychological first aid is often too simple. Waste of time, if I'm honest. PIAD Plus is a very, very good alternative. It's available in many languages, and there's a number of randomized controlled trials, and there's a number of randomized controlled trials underway. It uses evidence-based treatment by problem-solving, stress management, behavioral activation, excessive social support. And there are several of these kind of interventions. Like yesterday in the Yama, Rahman from Pakistan, he did a describes of a randomized control trial, a training lady health workers in Pakistan with a similar kind of very short 5-session, 4-session intervention, and that has effect. So this is often what we as mental health professionals have to do. Take these interventions, look which are evidence-based, and train them to people in the structure, isn't it? So this is what many of us do, psychosocial mental health education. You see an example of Cambodia. Many of us, we use kind of material. You see somebody thinking of different kinds of predicaments in life, and what may the effect on the right hand, to be hyper alert, aroused, to be depressed, to become a drunk. And here you see different kinds of self-help intervention groups in Cambodia for war widows, for adolescent sniffing glue, etc. This slide is based on the largest psychiatric epidemiological study ever, among about 120,000 people in more than 20 countries around the world. And then you see that the situation of mental health worldwide is extremely bad. Look at low-income countries. I would like you to look at these two rows. Low-income countries versus high-income countries. The burden of mental disease in low-income countries is 8% and in high-income countries 21%. The mental health budget in low-income countries is 0.5% of the health budget, whereas WHO advises at least to spend 6-7% of the health budget on mental health. It's 0.5%. In high-income countries, it's only 5.1%. Now, if you look at the treatment of physical disorder in low-income countries and high-income countries, physical disorders, 48% is recognized and treated in low and 65% in high-income countries. So these are physical disorders. But when you compare it with mental disorders, we only recognize and treat 6% in low-income countries and 24% in high-income countries. Despite decades of deinstitutionalization, everybody wants to deinstitutionalize, isn't it? They reduce psychiatric beds, etc., etc. 73% of the budget in low-income countries still goes to the psychiatric hospital, and not to public health, not to primary care, not to psychologists in the primary care situation. In high-income countries, it's still more than half of the budget. Only 7% of patients in low-income countries get aftercare when they are treated, and 45% in high-income countries. So this is a nightmare. This should be a wake-up call for all of us, because this is unacceptable. Treating serious mental disorder, epilepsy, schizophrenia, chronic psychosis, whatever you want to call it, is not more difficult than treating tuberculosis or giving maintenance treatment for HIV. There is no reason why we are so below the standard in other domains. So we really need to do an effort on all domains to get these figures high. The situation was financially very difficult in the world, because the assistance worldwide for health increased from $5.6 to $21 billion over this period, 17 years period. But almost nothing went to mental health and psychosocial services. So it was very hard in our field to find funds to do the job. But that's changing now. You know that non-communicable diseases got through at the UN in New York, and mental health and psychosocial services, they try to hitchhike on this new non-communicable disease fashion so that they get into the budget. So there is no money coming up for our field. That's very interesting. Anyhow, the situation in high-income countries is not better than in low-income countries. Don't think that Klaus and I, we are from countries from the most advanced services in the world in mental health. My country spends 20% of our health budget on mental health, but we don't do better. We do many things very good, very extensive, and we have about 75 times more psychiatrists and 75 times more psychiatrists in my country, in Holland, than in India or China, per capita. We have 250 times more per capita psychotherapists in Holland than in China or in India. And still we do a lousy job. So don't think you have to kind of take the models from the West and say, oh, what they do in the United States or what they do in Europe, it's fantastic. It's not true. I teach in the US, I teach in Boston. It's a nightmare. I think Europe is even better than the US. So what I want to say is develop your own models. Use these kind of materials and develop your own models bottom up. Okay, I go on. Then there are some challenges that I want to discuss with you. Some hurdles, as I see it. You know that we had this idea of alma mater, of primary care approach. You all have heard of alma mater, isn't it? In the 60s, when the 70s was 76. Since alma mater, when we said we have to integrate mental health to primary care, we need intersectoral collaboration between social workers, between educational people, between health people, between psychologists, etc. What we have seen since then is a whole range of vertical programs in the world. Instead of more integration, we see more distance. We have a vertical program for AIDS with a lot of money, we have vertical programs for tuberculosis, infectious diseases, we have very little integration. If you look at our literature, and you do a review, and you look at the people who talk about peace, about truth and reconciliation, like in Cambodia, about transitional justice, about mitigating emotions of impunity, anger, revenge, and non-violent upbringing of children, because if you beat children all the time in school, these children become violent fathers. Or you look at the economists when they talk about rural development, about income generation skills, occupational skills, microcredit schemes, stability of livelihoods. Or you look at the social sector being involved in rape victims, gender-based violence, former combatants, child soldiers, disaster prevention, disarmament, demobilization, reintegration. Or you look at the medical sector with communicable diseases like HIV, tuberculosis, or non-communicable diseases like diabetes, mental disorders. All these sectors, when you look at the literature, what do they say? They say the most important in our field is that we work on resilience, that we try to build up social capital, that we empower people, that we take care of community dynamics, that we strengthen social support, we work on information and communication, community competence, wellness and stigma. This is what we say. But these sectors, they don't tend to add to this. No, everybody wants to take a piece of this pie. So what we do is we all tend to set up our own little program with our own little flag, with our own little logo, with our own four-wheel drives that cost a lot of money, and where we put a big logo of our organization or a charity or an NGO or government services, and we then beat our breast instead of trying to put these resources together. Okay, the second challenge is try to get culturally sensitive and competent. And I want to spend a few slides on the famous PTSD and culture debate, which is a whole library. So I will try to condense that for you. And here I have a few slides. This is a Filipino being crucified. I just heard from Cecilia that still today in the Philippines with Easter, some people they get crucified like Jesus Christ, you know? This is no fun, this is real nails. It's not only the Christians who like this religious ecstasy. This is Muharram in Pakistan, the ritual. And this is how they flagellate themselves with blood pouring of their skins. Why do I show these slides? Is that we have to realize that when you talk about trauma, and you talk about culture, every part of trauma is filtered through culture. What is a traumatic event? What is the appraisal? What is the effect of spirituality or religion on how you appraise a traumatic event? coping styles, resiliency, social support, whatever, it's all influenced by culture. That's one of the things that we have to find out. Now, there's a big debate on PTSD and culture, and you can summarize that debate in three issues: ecological utility, validity, and politicization. I don't talk about politicization. Okay, now here you see Latin America, a few hundred million people each weekend in this part of Africa. They go in trance in Pentecostalist churches. All over the world, you see hundreds or thousands of expressions of distress or trauma, which is not PTSD, which may be epidemics of fear, you had the salt hysteria in China. Hundreds of thousands of Chinese, they wanted to buy salt because they thought salt protects against the Japanese Fukushima disaster. And they ran into shops and they wanted salt to protect the thyroid. So you see this phenomenon all over the world. Dissociation, trance, mass possession. You remember the old Koro epidemies in Malaysia, in Indonesia, where men thought that the testicles, the penis would withdraw, then they would die. So we have many of these collective phenomena of the world which have nothing to do with PTSD. Then there is a big validity debate. Yes, you do recognize PTSD all over the world. The PTSD construct exists, but the factor structure of the PTSD construct may vary around the world. And there is a lot of variation, meaning that even if you recognize the fact that PTSD can be found in all countries, doesn't mean that it's identical. Culture influences local phenomenologies, local idioms of distress. We may get back to that later, or a Cambodian colleague may talk about Kyol and other phenomena. Culture determines which symptoms we give attention to, which healing rituals we use. Then there's a big historicity debate where all kinds of scholars say, well, even in the old Greek literature or 4,000 years ago in Mesopotamia, you could find descriptions of PTSD. And this historicity debate is part of that validity debate, and you might say, well, who cares? Because all psychopathology changes over time. Depression changes over time. Schizophrenia changes over time. Schizophrenia is even quite a recent phenomena in the world literature. But indeed, depression, PTSD are phenomena that you may recognize 20, 30, 40 centuries ago. When you talk about this MH gap and this training of primary care workers and doctors and nurses, I think we need to add other resources. We need to add community resources. And in some of the abstracts that you have been written, you have been talking about community resources. We also need, in my view, we need to take healers much more seriously. There's good evidence for lay practitioners to be involved. In the exercise that we are later going to do, you have some questions about healers, one of your groups. We can do very derogatory about healers, but we have to realize that in low-income countries, about 50 to 80% of our patients go to healers. And healers are often very good psychotherapists. They may not have literature, they may not have an academia, but they have very good ideas. And let's not forget that in Australia and America and Canada, 50% of the outpatients also use complementary and alternative medicine. They also go to healers, despite having a good psychotherapist and a good psychiatrist. A slide on health systems. Now, when there is no disaster, this is what a health system is. There's the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Justice, there's the Health, Social Ministry, Criminal, there's professional associations, Ministry of Social Affairs, Education, universities, drug companies, NGOs. All these people, they play a role in the health system. All these people are the health system. November is a disaster. All these red groups, they come in, the rural developmenters, the 7, 8, 9 UN agencies, the diplomats, the blue helmets, human rights organizations, the NGOs, the disaster managers, and the experts, they all come in. Meaning that most of us have only a little bit idea about the health sector. We have very little idea about the rest. All these people who come in after a disaster, wherever you are in the world, they all want to act and they don't want to be coordinated. We have to realize that in our field, that as clinicians, we have to be much more managers of health systems. We have to learn to play another role in addition to the roles that we learned in university. So we need to be core team players that design projects, that develop projects, that supervise, that train others, instead of feeling that what we have to do is to treat, because that's what we are conditioned to. We are conditioned to treat people. That's our job. But of course, these disasters and those situations are kind of... It's important to realize that in psychology, the concept of resilience is changing from individual resilience as an individual trait to ecological resilience. There's a lot of literature and there's a lot of data on that. And that has to do also with the models we use in psychology. Normally, we talk, when you talk about children, for example, here's the exposure, and here are dependent variables, that is the distress of children. That's what most of us have been trained in. But then we realize that the model is more complicated because there's daily stresses. And then, when you look at children, the actual picture is even more complex when you set up a program or when you set up research. Here's the traumatic exposure, including abuse, violence, disaster. Then there's genetic, demographic, personal traits. There's the distress, and then there's mediators and moderators, daily stresses, and family dysfunctions, which are influenced by stigma, by disrupted social systems, loss of connectedness, moral breakdown, poverty, and parental mental health. So the models that we use are getting more complex, because if we shift from resilience as an individual character or trait to an ecological phenomena, the models we use to do our studies and to do our statistical analysis also get much more complex, of course. Then, what I said before, we have to deal with the whole spectrum of problems. Some are resilient, some people have psychological distress, some have common mental disorders, and then some have serious mental disorders. And just to show you a few slides on Nepali child soldiers, here you see that differences between children who were never conscripted versus children who were child soldiers, that we could part of this higher prevalence of depression, anxiety, and PTSD with boys and girls, we could explain part of it by the great exposure to trauma, but there was also a considerable part of the prevalence that could be only explained by reintegration problems of these boys and girls. So there was, on the one hand, there was the previous war exposure, but then there were also the daily stresses of getting back into the community and being reintegrated. And when you look at refugees in Europe and the US, you see the same phenomena. They're waiting in the asylum seeker centers. And while they wait, after 1 or 2 years, the rates of psychopathology, they double. And I think one of you has written an abstract on boredom in Indonesia, one of the islands. I think that's related to the problem of asylum seekers and refugees. So my conclusion. You heard something about a model that accommodates various variety of interventions. It's multi-sectoral, multi-model. multi-level, you can pick out pieces and adapt it. Prevention has to be adapted to the social cultural context. It shows something about how the different actors in the field can work together. It shows how the sectors of health, education, human rights, gender, and rural development can collaborate. It may help to identify gaps in our knowledge. And finally, we need to pool resources in our field instead of setting up our own program. We need to understand the PTSD and culture debate. I think we have to learn to address health systems in their complexity in the field. And I think it's good that we reflect on our own resilience and stress models. And if you want some papers, I can send them to you. And for now, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation. I really enjoyed it. It was full of positive points. I wanted to I don't want to ask a question, I want to give you a comment. I can change the way of giving a comment to the question too. Why the world or WHO or the governments don't look at all of the members of the family of mental health similarly, equally? The governments and WHO supports psychiatrists more than psychologists. And psychologists are really innocent. Psychologists need more support. Psychologists play an important role in mental health. In my own country, and I think in the whole world in general, psychiatrists don't let psychologists grow and reach at the same level because of financial way of their view. Or I don't know the reason. It could have. We can make a research, but it's very clear. We need more support. I'm an ordinary person, but as you are attached to WHO and you are international, I would like to ask you to be kind enough and follow the story and try to support psychologists more than before. We need it.
Well, I agree with you, but I think it's a different picture in different countries. Like in my own country, I think in part of Europe that's the same. I think that in Western Europe, psychologists have about the same status as psychiatrists. Last year, I understood that there is a Dutch mafia, and I didn't know what the Dutch mafia was until I came in Uganda, and then I heard that the Dutch mafia are my ex-students who now occupy center positions in UNHCR and WHO. And the people I've been working with all those years in Cambodia or Uganda or Namibia or Mozambique or Nepal or Sri Lanka, they don't have any prejudice against psychologists. They know that psychology is as important for this work as psychiatry is even more important. Because if you talk in the public health pyramid, the psychiatrist's effect only takes place in a tiny top portion of that triangle. A big, big, big part of the triangle below. That's community psychologists, that's clinical psychologists. So I think that psychologists are very, very fundamental. The advantage of my ex-students being in this work of this MH gap and the complex emergency work in both WHO and UNHCR, for example, is that they give a lot of attention to psychology. And they are psychologists. And they know that you can't deal with these issues by handing out pills. Look at our guidelines. It says, in fact, don't use any pills. Don't use antidepressants and benzodiazepines. Meaning, what do? It's all psychology. That's what these papers and what these media analysis say. But you need action.
But like, for example, to give you, I've been working in Eastern Europe, and of course that was under Soviet influence. If you talk about Russia, or you talk about Eastern Europe, doctors are always there, psychiatrists, and psychologists are here. And you can dance and spring whatever you want, but it's not going to change. So that takes 50 to 60, 70 years.
But you must start from a point.
You must start.
I'm talking about the majority of the countries, most of the countries in the world is like this. And WHO is responsible. It is one of the responsibilities of WHO to follow the story to solve the problem.
I agree, but you know, I think WHO is only one of the agencies. I think UNICEF is much more psychology oriented.
I mean, UN in general.
Yeah. That's true. The UN has very serious flaws. But to give you another example, I think the United States, nowadays it's very common to blur the borders between psychology and psychiatry. I know many, many psychologists in the United States who have become professors of psychiatry in all kinds of departments.
And the United States is only one country.
Yes.
Yeah.
But Canada has the same story, Australia has the same story, part of Europe is the same story. But I do agree with you. And it has to do with the fact that the medical profession often has more status. But don't forget that in the medical profession in many countries, psychiatrists are again very low in the hierarchy. Like in India, it's only when you're really a bit clumsy and a bit this and that that you become a psychiatrist. And many other specializations in India have much more status.
Psychiatrists suffer
the same problem in a way, you might say.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, but it's an important issue, and I think we all together need to work on this. I agree with you.
Yeah, I have a question about the public mental health. Do we need a new system for the public mental health, or we should combine the mental health service in the current public health system?
Your question is whether mental health should be part of the public health system.
Yes.
Yes, I think so. And the public health system is very wide, because the public health system is the health sector, is the educational sector. So when you want to work with children, adolescents, you often work through schools. You work through school psychology. So I think we should be integrated in the overall public health structure, especially when it comes to disasters or conflicts. Like when I went to Sichuan in your country after the disaster, what you did very quick in China, you very quickly had the whole infrastructure. People, they had emergency houses with a fridge and a bed and a table and a TV. It was an enormous achievement in China, the way you did that. I think it's quite unique in the world. So that's where the rural development, the technicians, the technocrats, where they are part of the public health structure. Well, then later, I think that's also one of your abstract for this, is that there was a huge lack of psychosocial interventions.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
So you need to work together in this public health structure to first address the first needs, which is the housing, the food, the drinking water, the shelter, because they are very important determinants of psychosocial well-being, isn't it? And they are the bottom of that pyramid, where you set up all that emergency interventions. And then on top of that, in that same pyramid, there we add, as psychologists and psychotherapists, we add our interventions. Is that an answer?
Yes. But in China, the mental health service is a part of the current public health. But they only focus on the serious mental health problems. So when I to communicate with the government, they told me we have paid for the public mental health. So we don't need to pay more for the psychological service.
Yes,
what you say, it's a big dilemma for everybody, also for the World Health Organization. The World Health Organization has had a policy for years where they said, there are so many people in the world with psychological problems, let's start with only the most serious problems, only the psychosis, the chronic psychosis, schizophrenia, the epilepsy. That's part of the policy of your government, isn't it? Yeah, which is a difficult choice. I mean, that's how they see it.
You need more time.
Yes, yeah. Because I think in terms of cost effectiveness and cost benefit, these common mental disorders, they are enormous burden to any economy in the world. But it takes time for the government to see that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
I'm happy to have finally met you. I require the students to read your journals. So to have a vast knowledge pertaining to the public mental health approach. This is an observation, the same type of question. I have observed for the last 20 years here, serving, you know, heavy interventions after disasters, and I observed that if the public mental health approach will not be sustained by some sort of a public system or public mental health system, or public health system, you know, the sustainability of the mental health services, including the entirety of the health services, will dissipate. So this is my observation, and I guess there are people here also involved in disasters. If it will not be part of a systemic approach,
yes,
then all interventions will just dissipate. I used to describe this in my experience. Philippine psychologists are really good in giving interventions in the immediate aftermath of a disaster. But the sustainability will slowly cease because this is not part and parcel of a health, a government health system. My question is, in your approach, or in the public mental health approach, how can we put some sort of an entry point to those places, particularly in rural areas, whom the government, or which actually the government, could not even penetrate?
Yeah, I have two reactions to your question. You know, WHO now has this idea about building back better, the BBB approach, building back better. And what they say is, you have many areas in the world where mental health services are neglected. And when there is a disaster, the disaster is an opportunity to do something that should have been done a long time ago. So they say the disaster attracts attention to psychosocial issues, and then they say a disaster is a way to build up something to open the eyes of the government. But I agree with your problem that intervening in the immediate aftermath is not so hard, but then to make it sustainable, that's very hard. And when you talk about sustainability, there are two issues in sustainability that's important. There's financial sustainability and there's functional sustainability. So when you train people, you can have functional sustainability, but then they also need a salary. And if you don't give them a salary, they won't continue. Working with volunteers, shown in many places in the world on the long term, it's very hard to maintain volunteers without any financial incentive. So when you set up something anywhere, I think you always have to look at where are anchor points where you could use local people that are already on the payroll of the government to do something. For example, when we went after Hainan, we went to Tacloba, I think I remember that there were the schools, they had a school psychologist. So then the local system had quite an elaborate kind of school psychology services within the Philippines. Now, I think that since they're already there and they have a salary, these are kind of anchor points where you can build on your program. But that's a big, big issue. So that's why often we use primary care nurses, village health workers, we use primary care doctors, because that's also one of the things that we did after Hainan. we said, well, train the primary care doctors, because the primary care doctors are there, they are part of the structure, they are funded, and they are part of a sustainable approach. But it's always a tricky thing. And I by the way, I think we need new kind of funding mechanisms for these kind of staff that you need sometimes. But we have to be very creative in trying to do that. And I think we also need much more, yeah, it sounds a bit strange to say that, but we need much more mathematics in our field in the sense that we have to allocate our funding in a much more rational way wherever we are in the world. For example, we still spend all this money on psychiatric beds. You don't need psychiatric beds to treat psychiatric patients. We just saw half of the budget, 75% of the budget in low-income countries goes to these beds. They're useless. You don't need them. You can treat them in a community. You can treat them in an ambulatory approach. Then you have money for your psychologists and your primary care workers. But it takes years to turn government, to turn their heads, and you need to work on all levels, on the ministry level, on the focal point level in the ministry, to change this mentality. It's very difficult. And these mental hospitals are a medical structure, they are status, and they are often a product of the colonial time. You know, in Indonesia, the Dutch, what we did, we built in Jakarta, we built in Batavia at the time, we built a psychiatric hospital, and I think in Bandung, and they are still there today.
Very quickly, more in Rooney, New Zealand, but maybe 20 years in the humanitarian field. So I identified, and thank you very much for your intervention. What I can hear is the difficulty of transition from the immediate response to sustainability that comes into some of our comments. And it's chronic, it's a perennial, and that I think is a really interesting area to look at. You said it was very important to have supervision. I totally agree with you. I've been training in the field for years and it doesn't last. People are not given the care they need to go on. Even if the people in after Tacloban, those school psychologists or counselors were trained, who then would be able to supervise them? I think there's a problem with the length of recovery. I've just been involved with discussing what recovery after disasters is in New Zealand. It's very topical today. We've had an earthquake yesterday. They're saying it goes in on day one with response, should last at least 3 weeks. We know when it comes to psychosocial problems, 3 weeks is not going to do it. So how do we deal with the transition in a creative way so that people who are left in the field dealing with situations have the support they need, both financial and, as you say, resources?
My name is Sudhin. I'm from Nepal. I'm working as a program manager in Accident Control Learning this year. My question is, as you talked in your presentation, the importance of bringing academics to the field and then doing research and developing our own kind of programs. What has your experience been in working in low-income countries, bringing academics for collaboration? What kind of incentives are needed for a long-term change?
I just have two clarificatory questions. One is, when you mentioned earlier that psychological first aid is too simple and, to put it bluntly, just a waste of time, I just like to find out just an elaboration of that statement. And I think that has implication, of course, with respect to, let's say, when immediately after a disaster or crisis situation, normally that's the first thing that they do is psychological first aid. So I just want some clarification of that part when you said that it's too simple and sometimes just a waste of time. And the second question, more of just a clarification as well as an elaboration of what you meant from, or the implications, particularly in terms of research, when you said that there's a shift now about resilience from individual to ecological. So in terms of what would be the implications of this in terms of research?
And I'm now focused on the MHGAP or the MHPSS. So some concern. First, the Department of Health, the MHGAP has been rolled out to the barangay level initially, MHGAP training. And number two would be in the MHPSS, there are, it's a one cluster of the DOH, which I actually have four cluster in disaster response. It's health cluster, nutrition cluster, and the WASH cluster. And finally, the MHPSS cluster, which is, I'm one of the task force. And also, some concern, like in addressing Pablo, we were able to train utilizing IOM, International Organization for Migration, the four modules, to train the barangay health workers to address the post-disaster. And of course, in Sendong, as you mentioned, there are overlapping of international community support. For example, there's so many, but I'll just give one. The portalettes. There are so many portalettes donated, and it's a waste. It's not being used because there's no one to handle the waste management for the portalettes because it's over number. And in Sambuanga Siege, there were already requests for responder on MHPSS, but we're just limited. So we were the ones also having some training in the local at the regional level. And of course, with the support of the Ateneo de Davao. And finally, in the Yolanda, there were a lot of support, but I observed overlapping, not only local, regional, but also international.
We often think we live in a rational world, but if you look at psychosocial issues after disasters and wars, you realize that there are some forces in the world somewhere. They determine where the priority is, and these priorities, they change every few years. So 2 years, the priority is democracy and human rights, and then it's child soldiers, and then it's former combatants, and then it's gender-based violence, and then it's another topic. And that means that often, due to some decision in Scandinavia or Canada or at the UN level, all the NGOs get funding in a certain direction. So for example, you're setting up a program as an NGO, or even as a government, you want to get aid, and then the money goes into another direction, and then you want to continue your work. So when I look at my previous NGOs that I set up and the ones that survived well, is that they do this. They go with all these fashions in the world. They follow the money. But wherever the money goes, they always add psychosocial and mental health. And they try to create synergy between these different sectors. So when there's a fashion 5 years of domestic violence and dealing with pregnant women and domestic violence, they go into this maternal care and they add the psychosocial component. And I think it's important, that's what I call the trauma scape. So there's often international forces, international politics, voting priorities, the UN has priorities, etc. And that determines to a large extent what's happening. And sometimes it's a pity, like for example in China after Sichuan, there were good people, but China decided to put all its money in the UNICEF intervention, child-friendly spaces. And there's a lot of money, billions of dollars going around the world in child-friendly spaces. But what UNICEF does has no evidence base. So we were invited in Sichuan to help them set up programs, and we went to Sichuan, and when we knocked the door of the local government, there wasn't a lot of money, the local government said, you know, we've spent everything on child-friendly spaces, so there was nothing left. So these are the kind of mistakes that you have to deal with. It's a very capricious, harsh world to try to survive. Okay, so next year in the Handbook of Cultural Psychiatry and Psychology, we'll have a chapter again on trauma escape. Your questions about academia and low-income countries. I think academics can help as long as when they do research with local people,
that they are able to really think in terms of cultural adaptation and cultural responsive and responsible kind of research, and not taking questionnaires from the United States and adapt them anywhere in the world, because that's what's happening a lot. In Nepal, you have very, very good examples like Brandon Court, who has done extremely sensitive research because he's an anthropologist and a psychiatrist. And he has done this beautiful research on idioms of distress in the mind-body, as you have it in Nepal, and then do the research with the child soldiers, one of the examples, some of randomized trials that you know about that we have been doing. What I find very difficult in low-income countries, if I'm honest, is what we have been trying for years, is that we said, okay, we want research questions coming from the local people, bottom-up, from the local communities. And we have seriously tried that, and that is very, very hard. Because local people, often they have very little idea about what research is, so it's very hard to really generate themes. Another big issue, in my view, that has to do with academia and low-income countries is that, like, we have always, one of our objectives was always to train local research capacity. Well, you can train local researchers, but then we all know that as researchers, if you don't do that all the time, you lose your ability. So you train a local team, they do excellent research, and then after 3-4 years, they get their new grant for some new research. But then you often have to start all over again. So in Cambodia, we have been doing very, very good studies, but in Cambodia there was often, we did a World Bank study on cost effectiveness, we did a study on epidemiology that we published in the JAMA. We are now doing the first longitudinal study on the national sampling in Cambodia of 1,200 Cambodians, following them up over 6 years with 4 ways, looking at the effect of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in Cambodia, again with a paper in the JAMA. But each time we set up a new study in Cambodia, we have to start from scratch. Because we have a team, they know how to do the research, and then after 3 years they're all gone. Doesn't mean they're lost. They may go to the University of Phnom Penh, they may get an academic position, but that's a big issue, this issue of doing permanent research when you train local research capacity so that people are able to continue that research. I think many of you have experience with that. Psychological first aid. I said if I'm honest. For example, when I went to Tacloban, it was my first time in the Philippines. And I discovered that in my, Filipinos, I know of course Filipinos in Holland, and some friends, etc. I think they're very warm people. They're very empathetic. They're very caring. They're very loving. Some of the people like Filipinos, like people in Haiti, they are very, very caring and loving. Now, what is psychological first aid? This is a psychological first aid is the fact that you teach people to apply the principles of Rogers, client-centered therapy, isn't it? It's empathy, it's trust, it's holding hands, it's caring, it's giving an arm around somebody. So, the people after Hainan, they have been doing psychological first aid because it's part of the culture. And then 6 weeks after the cyclone, then people from outside, they came and they said, you know, what you have to do? You have to do psychological first aid. And what it is you have to listen to people. Yeah, when they cry, you have to help them. But that's what they have been doing all along. So, psychological first aid, in my view, is for in a number of cultures, it's disempowering. Because people have already been doing it, and then you disempower them. Because people think, oh, I did something wrong. You know, what I did wasn't psychological first aid, it wasn't the structure of the manual. So, I think that's... And I'm happy that this PM Plus that I talked about is now, as a short-term 5-session intervention that can be done by lay people, by nurses, trained by psychologists, I think that's a perfect intervention that we can do
and that's now available. So I would suggest for the Philippines that you try to get that on board as quick as possible, this PM Plus. Yeah, of course, if you go with resilience from individual to ecological resilience, it has huge implications for your data collection. Because when you say it's the whole ecological system that determines what the outcome is after a disaster, you need to collect data on that level. Like some of the major hurricanes in the US and also, for example, in Liberia, this research, that what happens on the collective, on the community level, has a very important impact on the individual perception of trauma. So what happens at the village level is important. Talking about ecological resilience, after these hurricanes in the US, where the people got a house, whether the insurance company paid, whether they could start reconstructing, was often, the research shows, more important than the nature and the seriousness of the traumatic events that happened to them. So these are other ecological factors that determine the outcome of the trauma, and it means you have to collect data on these different ecological levels, and it means you have to analyze them. And I think Klaus is an expert on that, on multi-level analysis, which is then you get into kind of analysis with structural equation modeling, but other types of analysis which are very advanced and very difficult to do statistically, in my view.
Thank you.